is a hey, big party, man. Yeah, brother, I can dig it.
Stop. Right on.
Hey, man. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you die.
I think anyone who puckers up their lips and presses it against their boss's buttocks and then smooches is an ass kisser.
I seem to be inept at everything except my work. I'm good at my work, so I confine myself to that. All I want out of life is a 30 share and a 20 rating.
The man's enlarged my mind. He's a poet, warrior in the classic sense. I'm a little man. I'm a little man. He's a great man.
Think of it as colors. There's black and there's white. And in between is mostly gray. That's us. Now, gray is a tough color because it's not as simple as black and white. And for the media, certainly not as interesting. But it's who we are.
Leader fan, Fan Radio Network.
Tweet that.
And KFAN.com. 1 minute, 51 seconds past the hour, 3 o'clock Central Standard Time. It is a Tuesday edition of the Bumper to Bump Bumper Show on a still relatively balmy for this time of year, Tuesday afternoon here in the Twin Cities of Minneapolis and St. Paul. My name is Dan Barrero. I am the host of the program. Joined, as always, by Garzy, who is back. And we are delighted you chose to be part of today's festivities. Bradshaw and Brian, KFAN text line is open to you, 64686. And the Borden Volvo guest lineup is available to you as well. That'll include Kevin Seifert at the bottom of this hour. Is he coming in, do we think?
That's his plan.
Oh, good.
He said he should be in 3:30.
Well, if he is, we'll have two in-studio guests, because we do expect Luigi in studio, correct?
He's hopeful as
well. Hopeful, okay.
He's in town.
That would be 5:30. And in between, our old friend Gerald Posner will join the program, the outstanding investigative reporter, author, as we approach the 60th anniversary of the JFK assassination, November 22, 1963. That's tomorrow. Posner will headline, I think, a great back-to-back guest lineup on this subject. More on our guest in studio tomorrow between 3 and 4, later, in the show. But Posner will join us by phone today. He will be with us at about 4:30 this very evening. I think History Channel has a new JFK series, not just centered on the assassination as much as the legacy, the JFK family legacy, etc. I've taped it, DVR'd it. I have not begun watching it yet. It's on the History Channel. If any of you have, will you text me? Bradshaw and Brian, KFAN text line, 64686. Is it good? Is it interesting? Does it break some new ground? All those sorts of good things would be much appreciated. I mentioned off the top of the program, we are indeed your Respect Your Elders leader. Why would I say something like that? Well, I'm older than most on the station. It's an aging station in terms of the hosts, but I think at the top of that list. And so there's a part of me that wants to believe in that. You know, that mantra many of us of my generation grew up with and rolled our eyes about. Let's be honest. Oh, you got to respect your elders. Why? What if they say something stupid? What if they do something stupid? I still got to respect them? Hell, yeah, you do. Now, I'm not sure it's all that bad a message.
I like it.
I think it actually...
I tend to like it.
The older you get, the more you understand the concept behind it. But in this case, I'm applying it to the hottest team in professional basketball, your Minnesota Timberwolves. Tibbs came to town yesterday, red hot. They'd won 3 in a row. And I think 7 of their last 8, something like that. They were wrapping up a long road trip. And they wanted to wrap it up the way we did, with a victory. And for a couple of quarters, They kept coming at us. And I looked upon it as, okay, this is a good test because Tibbs' teams don't quit.
Right.
It's one thing we know about him. They ain't going to stop playing. He's not going to allow them to stop playing. They may get beat, but he ain't going to let them stop playing. So they're going to keep coming.
Brunson will be in the game until there's 12 seconds left, no matter what the score
that's
is.
Exactly,
and that's
right.
Essentially what happened.
And that's exactly what happened. And then in the third quarter, I mean, so I'm constantly looking at tests. Okay, we've been passing some tests this year that we've rarely passed. And can we pass another one, which is they're going to keep coming after us, and they do have some advantage. They're a very good offensive rebounding club, and they're a good three-point shooting club, as we talked about yesterday, although they weren't hitting very many of their shots yesterday. How much of that was our defense? How much of that was just them missing shots? Probably likely a combination of both. So I'm saying, all right. How are we going to, do we understand the foe? And the third quarter revealed that we did. The third quarter, we said, we're not going to mess around with this game. We're not going to let them keep flirting with the possibility of stealing the game. We're going to bust it open. And largely, that's what the Wolves did in the third quarter. Workmanlike. And professional. Now, you could say it should have been an even bigger lead than it was, but as it was, what did they end up going to the fourth quarter? Was it like 17-point lead, 15-point lead? In that range. And they then really were never, I don't think, seriously threatened in the fourth quarter. And what made last night, I think, compelling and perhaps unusual is who the crowd seemed most interested in appreciating. Anthony Edwards, when he gets going, as he did in the third quarter after a very pedestrian first half, is always going to get the love. When he had an unbelievable reverse layup.
Yep.
On a spin move that was tremendous.
Had a nice steal for a dunk.
He had a great steal at exact the end of a quarter, I think, wasn't
pretty
it?
Pretty close.
Yeah, yep. It was tremendous. You're right. Got two more quick points that way. Cat, the way he's playing or has played lately, is going to get some appreciation, even in front of a crowd that tends to get frustrated by his grimaces, by his looks. And he was doing a lot. He was reverting a little bit on that.
And he fouled out again.
And he did foul out again. In this case, it didn't hurt us. He was one of, I think, two of our big men who fouled out in the game because Nas did as well late.
Yep.
And really, I mean, those are the two guys. I mean, they're the straws that stir the drink to a large extent. But yesterday, it was about Rudy Gobert. There was a Rudy chant. A year after, as our guy John Athletic pointed out, he still hasn't gotten me out of that double paying for an Athletic subscription, but more on that later. A year removed from an unsettled crowd that occasionally was delivering a smattering of boos to Rudy Gobert. He didn't like it. He talked about it. In fact, that night after the game, we tried to warn him. Worst thing you could do to any crowd, I think,
yep,
including ours, you tell them it's unfair to boo or I don't really like that, you're going to get it even worse next time. Last night, it was subtle, non-scoring plays from Rudy that had people on the edge of their seats. There was an appreciation for the nuanced way that Rudy has emerged, or you could say really reemerged this season, as a defensive / rebounding presence. Rudy is old by NBA standards. I don't know his age. Maybe you could look him up. Mike Conley is even older by National Basketball Association standards.
Rudy's 31.
It's really not that old, is it?
Nope.
It feels older than it is. I think that's because of what happened last season. You felt like, well, he's not. And he would have been 30 last year, and it felt like he was playing like a 37-year-old.
And Mike Conley is 36.
He's 36. There you go. And I like to think, first of all, I love to see a player who's contributions to the team are not all that related to what he can do scoring the basketball. Although, high percentage yesterday, dunks, take them. You know, right under the basket, layups, take them. You don't have to ever apologize for taking those. But that's not where Rudy has excelled this season, and it's not why the Wolves find themselves in the rarefied air of 10-3 and first place in the National Football Conference. No, that'd be, I guess, the Western Conference of the NBA. It's the little defensive things. It's not just blocking shots, but harassing shots. It's activity in the passing lanes. Just getting a hand in here, making things difficult for the other club. And I'll take you back. I'll take you back to our second, well, no, I guess you can't call it an alarming loss. It was a disappointing loss, the only loss on the road trip. We got crushed by the Suns, 133-115. We had all the excuses in the world. They call them in the business. There is even, they're so ready-made.
The term?
NBA even has a term that they use, which only encourages this whole concept. A schedule loss.
Schedule loss.
Because it was a night before, and we got in at 3 a.m.
Has nothing to do with how you played or the fabric of your team. It's everything to do with the schedule.
Schedule L. Yeah. Exactly it. And there was never going to be any sin to losing to Phoenix, even though the big three didn't all play in that game, as it turned out. Two of the three did. It was the way they lost. They kind of got routed. They weren't in it from the beginning. Their defense was awful and extremely casual, which has been, fortunately, not the norm this season, but it stood out all the more. And people got mad at me for being negative about what I saw defensively, and they said, you're not going to win them all. And I said, no, I'm not here to hammer them. I'm really not hammering them at all, but I'm not here to say, I'm aware you're not going to win every game. Doesn't mean you're obligated to lose the game the way they did. And it was the elders. And this should not go forgotten several games, couple games, and great success later, who, to me, sent great and mature messages after that game. Do you remember what Rudy and Conley said?
I do. I talked about it the next day. You were out. We talked about this a little bit.
That's good. Rudy. Now, let me back up. Anthony Edwards was, well, they're hitting every shot.
Yeah.
What are you going to do? What do you want to do? We're not going to beat them on day where they're hitting every shot. It's not my fault. You know, if we told Rudy to just goaltend everything, maybe we would have had a chance.
Yeah. What I like about these elders, you're going to read two different things. They each have different theories.
Exactly.
Different ways you can go about handling the tough schedule.
Exactly it. Here was Rudy. If you want to have the level of success that we want to have, we do have to come out with a little more urgency and physicality.
What do you mean?
You can say, yes, I fell asleep at 6 a.m. Yes, it was a back-to-back coming from the West Coast and everything, but I do think there's a lot of things that we can control. And we didn't do those things in the first half. Ding, ding, ding. That's maturity. That's the right message being delivered to this team. It was the way they came out defensively. I mean, Phoenix could have scored 70 points in the first quarter. I don't remember. As it is, they might have scored 70 in the first half. And then there's the even older Mike Conley. How about this idea? If we would have handled business, this is the paraphrase. If we handle the business better against Golden State that was without Steph Curry in our previous game and then was without Draymond and Klay Thompson, well, then maybe we're not playing 42 minutes or 35 minutes or into the fourth quarter. Here's his direct quote. It's a lesson in even Tuesday night's game. You have an opportunity to go in. They're out a couple guys. Try to take care of that game, and maybe you can rest a little bit more coming in here tonight. Instead of wasting so much energy mentally and physically like we did last night, lesson learned. So they're getting not just good play from the two veterans, they're getting maturity and the right messages being delivered. And on good teams, it has to be delivered by more than the head coach. And now Rudy, because he's playing better, has elevated his stature once again to a place where I think other players have to accept it. I'm not sure they would have accepted any messages from him last year because he wasn't playing at the same level. They might have from Conley, but he wasn't there from the beginning of the year. Text me, and we'll get into this in a little more detail, and we'll set up the rest of it.
Reach us here at The Fan.
I Another key quote that's getting some attention from 600 First Avenue last night. Karl Anthony Towns. We all have the will that's needed to win on a daily basis because we've seen how when you don't have the will, how seasons turn out. We also understand Minnesota has lacked in one word, and that's execution. If we execute at a high level, we can see our fortunes change here. Another encouraging comment. And why does it sound more encouraging? Because the Wolves are showing it on the court. How many years have we talked about Cat always tries to say the right thing, but he might as well shut up? Or even several other players. This isn't just about him. About, we got to do this, and if we do this, we got to do this better. And at some point, you at least I stopped giving the players any points for articulating what was wrong. Because if you don't do something about what you see, who cares? It's the old, you know, how many times can you give somebody a full pelf for saying it's on me? I didn't have it tonight. I let my teammates down, or I let my team down, if you don't do something about it. After the fifth or sixth time, it doesn't sound like accountability anymore. It just sounds like you're desperate and you don't know what else to do. Because you can't take care of it on the ice or on the court or on the field. And so that comment sounds more mature in part because through, admittedly, it's only 13 games, they're playing most of the time as if they mean it. The biggest exception is that Atlanta game, which now doesn't look as bad as it did then. Right. Because now it just looks like, well, that was the lemon. You know, you're going to have them over the course of the season. Maybe the Toronto game, but I don't think so all that much. That was the opener. And even the Phoenix game was disappointing for the reasons we just laid out. And I like that the elders tried to send a two different not-so-subtle messages. But doesn't it sound better? Because, well, yeah, we're seeing it. We can watch it happen in real time. We can watch a game. It feels 50-50 and feels like we're going to get outwilled. We're going to get that we're more talented. Now, we lost. You could even argue it was evened up a little bit because we lost our best defender, Jaden McDaniels, right, to an ankle injury.
Yep.
But you feel like, well, yeah, I mean, New York is deep. They've got a lot of options, but you still look at it and say, well, I mean, our big two should still be better than their big two, quite frankly. But you say, yeah, but the will gets in there, and they're going to keep grinding, and they're going to keep grinding. And as I said, it looked like a toss-up kind of a game, potentially at the half. It was all going to depend, really, I think, on what happened in the third quarter. And in the third quarter, somebody went to Anthony and said, game started about an hour ago. We're going to need you, second half. We're going to need some offense from you, even if you're trying to do other things. And you look at the numbers, the most fascinating number, look at the box score and look at the assist totals.
It was like 30 on 41.
Yeah,
shots,
and it
right?
was like everybody had assists. Everybody had good to very good assist numbers. It wasn't just the people who have the ball in their hands all the time.
Towns 4, Conley 5, Ant 5, Slo-Mo 5, Troy Brown Jr. 2.
That's tremendous.
Shake Milton 4.
That's what you're looking for.
Nah 3.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, think about it.
The ball was not sticky.
No, and in the third quarter, it's like we're not going to let them out Willis. We're actually going to see, we're going to test them. And they bent. They didn't stop playing exactly from an effort standpoint, but you could see that, all right, they kind of knew that this wasn't going to go anywhere, right? And I got to tell you, I used to like, who's their second best player, or at least in principle?
Are you talking about the one that they were going to send for us?
Randall,
for Karl
right?
Anthony Towns? Yes,
what's
Julius
his first
Randall.
Name? Julius.
Julius.
His reemergence there was a hell of a story for a while, and I thought, wow, this is a good player. You know, he's figured it out, yep. Or Tibbs. I don't want to get near him. The ball stops for 9 seconds with him every time. Now, occasionally he can make the play.
Yep.
But Everybody else is standing with him.
It's a hard way to play.
Oh, my God. I just think it's an impossible way to play. I wouldn't even. That was the guy, allegedly. And what's interesting is the Knicks, all the rumors are still there. They feel like, well, maybe we've hit our ceiling, so we want to go get Towns. And again, because New York is very New York-centric, the assumption is, well, it doesn't matter that the Wolves are 10-3.
Right. Cat's playing great.
They'll be willing to help us.
Yeah.
Because they want to help us get better more than they want to help themselves be relevant. And somebody's got to go to the New York folks and say, that ain't going to happen now. That's not even a possibility at this point, leaving aside that the guy you're going to offer in return is a morale drain.
Well, that was the deal even
then.
Back
yes.
when it was possible, when people, and I never wanted to do it, as you know, but even when it was more believable that it could possibly be a rumor that
yes.
Towns was being shopped, that deal never, ever made sense to me. Oh, yeah, Julius Randle, bring him back, not at all.
Yeah.
You mentioned just the aesthetic of watching it and how they're playing. I'll go back to game one of last year against OKC when it was a closer game than it needed to be. Wolves got out to a big lead.
Mm-hmm.
And how many times, like, no one could grab a rebound, and it would just, like, bounce in front of, like, three different people. I said this after the Denver game, I think, or one of the games that I went to. Like, the only reason anybody's going to be mad at Rudy this year, a teammate, is if he's stealing their rebounds. Because now multiple Wolves are going after.
That's it.
Like, they are fighting each other over rebounds. That's how hard
they're
playing on the
glass.
Now, the
first half,
they
got nailed on the offensive boards a little bit, and then they apparently made that a priority.
And when it's time, though, when it's time to do it, they've
been
doing
it.
And that's a huge part of defense,
too.
It's just limiting them to one shot and taking it the other way, and that's what they're doing.
And again, after some slippage defensively, which we've acknowledged and discussed, they played tougher defense yesterday, and when, you know, we're back to contesting more shots, you know, the getting in the passing lanes, et cetera, et cetera. Let's do this. As I mentioned, Gerald Posner will join at 4:30, Lou Nanny in studio in the 5, and when we come back, Kevin Seifert will get caught up on his reaction, leftover stuff from our victory. No, it wasn't a victory. It felt like a victory, but it wasn't, a loss in Denver. And what we have going forward this week as well, Kevin Seifert, ESPN.com. If you have questions or observations for him, please pass them along via the Bradshaw and Bryant KFAN text line 64
on the Fan.
Check out the Friday Football Feast this week. Buffalo Wild Wings in Savage. Doors open at 8 ahead of a live 9 to noon broadcast with PA in charge. Football, wings, and prizes. Join them for all of it. Find a full list of dates and locations at KFAN.com. Keyword calendar.
Kevin Seifert, do you guys do weekly official, like ESPN Pro Football Power Rankings?
We do.
I mean, I know a lot of individual people do it, but is there an ESPN one that's allegedly like a consensus or a bunch of people?
Yeah.
Or how's that?
Right. Every Tuesday, in fact. If you're going to ask me where the Vikings are, I'm not totally sure because I can't remember the last time I looked at a power ranking, but we do publish them every Tuesday, and it's a compilation of all of our football writers and reporters.
Disappointing. I mean, it's a failure on your part. You're a beat guy who's supposed to know. Pro Football Talk has theirs.
Okay.
And I think they have the Vikings, I want to say 12th, behind the Seattle Seahawks, which I thought was disrespectful, but maybe I'm not respecting the Seahawks enough. I don't know.
Maybe they're taking into account the potential loss of Geno Smith, although it sounds like he's playing, but we'll see.
I think it was Seattle 11, Vikings 12. Does that sound about right? I mean, not that it matters. Is that a little low for us, or what do we think?
In the entire NFL,
the whole
NFL. I think that, I think power rankings are pure entertainment, and like there's almost no actual insight involved in them. But they are fun to talk about, and I would say, like, I think if the best way to connect it to reality is that the Vikings are a mid range team with it, you know, along with most of the rest of the league. And if some things go right, they are above the average, and if some things go wrong, they're below it.
I'm on the power rankings right now. A writer named Kevin Seifert on the Vikings says Cousins was making a strong play to return as Vikings starter next season, suffered a season-ending rupture of the right Achilles. Blah blah blah. Certainly, people in the organization, Josh Dobbs, Kwesi Adolphe-Mensah, will have to weigh the value of a player who'll be 36 next season, coming off the first serious injury of NFL career.
Disclaimer?
Well, for this week's
power rankings, we were asked to revisit a person we put on the hot seat at the beginning of the year, and I had Kirk Cousins on the hot seat.
Yes.
Because entering the year with no contract and all that sort of thing. So I had to revisit the hot seat of a player who's no longer in the lineup.
I won't spoil how hot the seat is. I'll let people go click that, Kevin.
Yeah. Oh,
thanks. I don't want to spoil that.
No.
But the Vikings are 13th in the ESPN power rankings.
Similar.
There
you go.
From 15.
Middle of the road.
Went up two spots after a loss.
Let's get to the elephant in the room. We got some of these yesterday. The Kirkobos are back. Kirkobos, who had a couple of tough weeks because they wanted to pile on after a couple of Vikings losses. And then the Vikings had, with Josh Dobbs, they had the audacity to win.
Yeah.
And they go, God, well, I guess I can't go with the lecture about now do you miss my guy, Kirk?
Yeah.
We lose a game. And now it's, do we appreciate Kirk more and do we understand how important he is? To that end, Texter Guy writes, I'm sure this is going to be a topic of discussion. I think what we saw on Sunday night was perhaps even overdue. People now will have a little bit of film on Dobbs, and he's regressing back to the mean a bit. He still demonstrated some very good athleticism in the field, but made a few mistakes. You will get that, and he finally showed us some. I can't say I'm surprised or even flustered. All this is still new, and I think without him, we would have lost the game by halftime. So that's the prevailing wisdom, that reality is setting in on Dobbs, and it revealed itself, especially in the second half. I don't know that I necessarily agree.
Yeah.
But I'd like to get you to address that very issue and how you view him after the most recent game.
I am viewing him the same way I did in the other games, which was not as probably as excited or optimistic as everyone was. And I view this whole situation as, and I keep wanting to hammer it home, they're on QB4. Usually when a team gets to QB4, the season is over. In the Jets' case, they got to QB2 and their season
and
was over.
Yeah.
So anything that the Vikings are getting or Dobbs is doing to get them positive wins or positive play is more than could have reasonably been expected. So I think even though he did have the interception and he fumbled the ball on a hit that has now left a player suspended for 4 games, I think they've gotten as much as they possibly can out of him, and he's basically still doing what they need, which is to keep him in games. And in some cases, he's helped them win games, and that is the way I viewed him before, and I'll continue to view him now. If he continues or makes more mistakes and doesn't sort of balance them out with some plays that put him over that line of expectation, then maybe we start talking about something else. But he was as responsible for anybody on the offensive side for keeping them ahead for most of that game.
Yeah, I even thought the second half, look, the last time they got the ball, nothing good happened, right? And some of that may be on him. Some of that is the offensive line didn't hold up. Did he not make the right reads there? I'll leave that to greater football minds. But even in the second half, I thought he made enough plays. And let's face it, for me, the ball game turned on the Madison fumble. That's the play. They're at the 35, 34-yard line.
Cruising.
They're cruising. They had just scored on their last possession. They'd held Denver, and they're going in for 3 minimum. And everything changed there. And Madison's not a quarterback with the ball. He's a running back with the ball.
Yeah.
It was not even a difficult strip at all. That's just a play that can't happen. And even on that drive, I mean, he had a couple of nice pass completions that kept that thing going. So, I'm with you. I'm not ready to crown him, but I don't look at it as he was. If I'm listing the reasons why they lost this last game, I don't have him real high on the list.
Yeah, and I would say, like, the one thing that's missing from their offense that Cousins would undoubtedly provide is just the consistent downfield passing.
That's fair.
I mean, he has had, he has, I think, probably the best downfield pass he's thrown that I can think of off the top of my head is the touchdown to Hockenson in the Saints game.
Yes.
It was kind of a post right down the middle, really nicely played thrown ball. But Hockenson got open deep and he kind of threw a ball that went, he didn't have against the other night against Denver. Hockenson's open deep and probably would have been a touchdown with a better throw. It kind of went up and down. He did have the, right before the Madison fumble, he had a nice pass to Josh Oliver down the field.
Exactly.
So he's had some instances of it.
Play of the drive.
But I'll be interested when Justin Jefferson gets back, like, what will the what will that look like? And
isn't that another big piece of this that we've now taken for granted? Yeah. That a guy who's a backup quarterback, that's all he's ever been, doesn't even have the best receiver in football, which now I'm not saying that changes everything, but the Kirk Cobos sure as hell bring it up if he doesn't have Jefferson. They go, what do you expect him to do without JJ?
Yeah, absolutely. And that's where I think it'll be interesting, because my perception is that if you wanted to downgrade, the Josh Dobbs for something, that you're not getting the same kind of consistent downfield throwing that you're getting from Cousins. But maybe that'll change with Jefferson. I don't know. But the accuracy on those type of passes may not be as good as the guy who was a top 10 quarterback in the league for the whole season. And that's not a slap or a shot at him. But I think that, like, if you're talking about their offense and you're talking about, like, is it time to be done with Dobbs or Cousins is clearly better, that's the area where you say that's the sort of the friction point.
Speaking of conspiracy theories, here's another texter. How come only Lieber, as in Ben Lieber, has the guts to even hint that JJ should probably be okay to play this week, which I interpret as maybe this is also contract related? We're starting to get the conspiracy theories on That's the Whisper, that this is his own way, you want to call it passive aggressive or even aggressive, that JJ's reminding people, we didn't get that contract taken care of before the season began, so I'm going to take my sweet time. I'm going to say that not only to the fantasy football people on my ass, but I'm going to say it to my own team. Do you buy any or all of that conspiracy theory?
I mean, I don't know how much of a conspiracy theory is, because everyone's been sort of out in the open on their, and what they've said out in the open suggests that this would be the path it was going to be all along. O'Connell says from day one, we're going to bring him back when he's 100%. Jefferson says, the first time he talked publicly after the injury, I'm not going to come back until I'm 100%. He also adds, I want to be a Hall of Famer. You can't be a Hall of Famer just by sitting out games just for the fun of it, or just because a team is not, because that was the original theory, is that it would be based on how well the Vikings are doing.
Right.
So now they're in the playoff race. And so that now the theory has to change because, contract.
Yeah,
they're very fungible.
They move,
fungible.
That's a good word.
And so that's sort of the perception I've operated all along. Like, this was not going to be something where they were going to bring him in just for red zone, or bring him in just for first downs, or just for third downs, or like this. They just weren't going to do it. And I know that it's much more alluring to try to find a conspiracy theory that suggests that he's trying to prove a point, other than, when the head coach is on the record saying, like, this guy is somebody who's going to be here 10 or 15 years. You can damage yourself for a longer period of time. We don't want to do that. And everyone assumes he's just covering for him, or everyone assumes that he's just making up something he doesn't believe in because he doesn't want to, call out Jefferson. And maybe one day we'll find out that was the case, but he hasn't had one practice yet where he's participated fully. So I'm not sure where the gap is that, like, what we're missing here to suggest that he's ready to play and been ready to play, and he just hasn't.
How many games has he missed now?
Six.
So he's missed six.
Mm-hmm.
So if he misses Monday night, that would be seven, right? If I'm doing my math right,
I think that's how it rarely goes. Yeah.
So, I don't even know what the right number is, because what you say that O'Connell says actually sounds very reasonable to me. If you're a Vikings fan, and you believe that this guy's the best player in football, and we can have that argument, okay, say top three or four, whatever, then you don't want to mess around with this.
No.
Right? I mean, the idea that this is just him orchestrating it all to because he's still mad that the contract didn't get done. I mean, it's kind of asinine to think you want to, as a team, cut your nose to spite your face if you think he is that important, not only to the rest of this season, but to your future. I don't know what the right rule is on hammy. Like, is 6 weeks normal? Well, is 9 weeks
there's
absurd?
There's no rule. It's a subjective, it's not like a broken bone that you're waiting for it to heal and the x-rays tell you when it's healed. It's like, it's different for every person.
Okay. All right. So does your gut tell you he will not play this week?
If I had to guess, I'd say there's a better chance of him not playing than playing.
Are we one bad quarter away from seeing the return of Jaren Hall? There's a couple people who are clamoring They said, no. I really was intrigued by what I saw from Jaren Hall before the concussion.
Yeah.
And so now they've seen enough of Dobbs, and they're going, we don't want Mullins. We have no interest in Mullins or Mannion. We want to see that kid. He looked like he had a little something, a little extra juice.
He's actually, he was ruled out. I mean, I don't think the concussion thing is fully, at least as of Friday, which was the day they had to rule him out. So he was not available. Even if your guy, you know, the texter guy, you know, was in charge, he couldn't have played him because he was ruled out because of the after effects of the concussion. But if, you know, it'll be, if something happens to Dobbs, it's going to be Mullins. And that's just the way, I mean, people just need to accept that.
That's unfortunate.
It was the player that they went into the season as the backup.
Yeah.
He best fits the offense they created for Kirk and for Justin. And, in terms of just his particular skill set, and I guess I'd be shocked if that weren't the case, if something were to happen to Dobbs.
Is it, Garzy indicated, did the head coach get a little owly with you guys, which is rare for him, by his standards, when it was maybe brought up that, you know, that cute play where your tight end pitches to your quarterback on third and one in the first quarter. What are you doing? Did he get a little cranky?
He didn't have a great explanation for why he thought it would work or that it was a good call, other than if it had worked, it would everybody would be jumping up and down and be happy. I think where he got himself, you know, owly, whatever the word is, like, he was trying to explain why he thought it was an illegal hit.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a nuance of rules that I struggle with as well. And so I think he was going down that road and then decided, like, I'm done talking about this.
Yeah.
And that was where it was. I didn't take it as him being upset that he was being challenged on that play as much as it was a struggle to try to articulate why he thought it was an illegal. And also didn't want to be perceived as basically sour grapes that my play would have worked if the guy hadn't come in like a missile with his head down.
Interesting comment by another texter that the Vikings, to an extent, have themselves to blame for the people who do want to believe there's a conspiracy involving JJ, and he is trying to play hard to get here, reminding us that, well, we certainly played along with Hockenson. We did the word salad game when we knew full well that Hockenson was doing one of those passive-aggressive kind of protests until he got the new contract, so you reap what you sow.
Yeah, and that's and I actually thought about that as I was answering your question earlier, and probably should have mentioned it. Like, there is precedent for it, even though to this day no one has really gone on the record to say it. We all just kind of have the I wouldn't say assumption, because there was more reporting behind it than assumption. But nobody went on the record and say, yeah, I know we said this and all, but really we were just letting him get away. But no one's actually challenged that either, and so I think we all felt pretty confident in reporting that this was, you know, at least partly related to the contract and then the timing of his of Hockenson's return. And so it did seem as though the Vikings played ball with him on that, and when it could have been a lot uglier, and, you know, if they wanted it to. And Justin Jefferson has only more stature than TJ Hockenson in the organization. And so why they would choose to play ball with Hockenson and then not, and then challenge Jefferson, that wouldn't make any sense either. But I also, like, just based on the evidence that, you know, that I have to this point, I don't have, you know, any reporting or any evidence
JFK
to suggest.
Assassination anniversary date is tomorrow. So everybody's kind of in a conspiracy mood.
I know.
They're trying to attach conspiracies to everything.
And I worry sometimes I'm sounding naive and just saying, like, well, Justin Jefferson would never do that, or Kevin O'Connell would never sit by and allow that. But there's just a lot of circumstances to suggest that that's not what we're seeing. And that, yes, has somebody played in an NFL game in the history of the league with a hamstring that's in the current condition of his? Probably.
What grade pull was it? Do we know?
We don't know that.
Do we have grades of pull on hamstrings?
Well, it goes like, yeah, 1, 2, 3. And I think third is like a tear.
Cat was his calf strain was a 3, wasn't it, Garzy? We were originally told it was a 2.
It was a bad 3.
He got frustrated and said, "Wow, well, that's why everybody got mad at me, because it was off. It was hinted that it was a 2 when it was really a 3." So I don't know
and
how
the
this
3
all
is
fits
like
up.
3 is like basically torn off the bone, you know. And so that, you know, that
we don't think it's a 3, or might it be?
I don't
can't be a 3. He wouldn't be back at all.
I don't think so. Okay. He eventually would be back, but like, he wouldn't be walking the way he was the day after. So, but again, like, you're also talking about a player who's as reliant on a 100% hamstring as anyone, because of what the particular skill set required to his position, and not him in particular, but any receiver. Like, if you can't run, or you're in a condition where if you run a certain amount, you're going to re-injure it. And there's lots of data and research on how much you can do with a hamstring in a certain condition before you're in danger zone. Maybe I'll turn out to be the most naive person ever and had the wool pulled over me, but I'm just not going to hint or suggest it unless I have some evidence of it.
Rules clarification.
Okay.
If Dobbs fumbled on the fateful play in question before the illegal hit, the ball's already dislodged. Does that have any impact on if they'd have called the flag there, but he fumbled first and then they did the helmet to helmet, is the entire play nullified or does Denver keep the ball?
I think it was still a live ball. Like, it wouldn't have been considered a dead ball foul. Like,
okay.
You see that, like the whistle's blown and then some guy comes out of nowhere and
play's
they're fighting.
Ongoing. Yeah. Okay.
The play is ongoing. So I, as far as I know, that would have, nullified the fumble recovery.
Did the hit cause the fumble? Because I thought the ball was already starting to come out.
Yeah, there's been talk of that. Yeah, and I guess I didn't go as a pruder to bring it to the November 22nd. But he that's why I said, like, there's a lot to talk about with that play, and the hit is only one of the things. But, like, the hit was clearly the headline, but he was not. I don't think he was going to get the first down regardless. I think he was short of the first down no matter what. So it didn't even work regardless of the hit.
Kevin Seifert joining us in studio. Larry Mondello guy has checked in.
Oh.
We all know Seifert to be a great writer, but the piece Gardzi read from today was a work of art. Blah, 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 blah. What a true wordsmith. Seifert.
ESPN Plus subscription is absolutely worth it for stuff like that.
I had no idea.
I think he just quoted the garble. And that's
very Hemingway-like.
Yeah.
You've been compared to him from time to time.
That was my nickname from Fred Zambrilletti. But
by the way, what are we going to do? Everybody wants Chandler to be the starter.
Yeah.
Everybody's mad at Matt. They're intrigued by the extra burst from Chandler.
Yeah.
And they're down on Madison because of the fumble.
Mm-hmm.
What are the NFL rules? Like, in the case of the Gophers, how quickly did PJ banish his fumbling running back?
Game, he put the ball on the ground three times, didn't play for like a month.
For like a year, right?
Came back in, fumbled again.
So what are the NFL rules, or are the Vikings rules in part dictated by they don't have that many options?
No, they don't have to have him active. They don't have to have him on the team.
They mad at him?
They're mad at the fumble, but we already have seen enough evidence that they are extremely loyal to him. They really like him. He is a great guy. And a good locker room person.
We're not in here for good guy.
I know. I'm just saying, like, all those things, like, I get why they like him. I get why they
He picks up a blitz, they tell me.
And he does. And to be fair, Ty Chandler, this happened in the preseason and it happened in some regular season games. You can see this happening live when the quarterback has to like point at a guy and say over there.
Not
like
a good sign.
He wasn't lining up. And it happens. He's a younger player. And like in their minds, he was not ready. They didn't trust him enough, and forget about like pass protection and all that kind of stuff. But just like you do that a couple times at the NFL level, you've buried yourself for a while. And so I think he did. And like they never had a question about whether he could run. And they trust him in the special teams role where he's now had two really nice fake punts that have been, they've been trusted.
That might have been as good a fake punt play as I've ever seen, because there was literally nobody. The only outside guy pinched in. And it was like, why? You could have made that run around the end.
Well, I don't know about that, but with my physiological condition. But
before the ankle.
Yeah, before
the ankle.
You
could have.
Absolutely. But it was, the hero of that was the long snapper guy who, like, was standing, was lined up normally and somehow got a side snap. I mean, that's
impressive.
That's the work of art.
That's very true. That's an underrated part of that play.
But again, I think Chandler has started to earn more trust now. Matt Daniels was saying today that he had actually come to him and wanted to be the up back on the punt, and they trusted him with that, and they're seeing more of it. I just think that and when I asked Wes Phillips today, and it was interesting, the offense coordinator, and he was sort of talked around the idea that, I asked him, could Chandler be your lead back? And he didn't say no. He said, we'll keep talking about that. So I think they're intrigued with the fact that he has a different gear. And obviously, they're not happy with the fumble of Madison, but I don't think that they're down on him in the PJ Fleck style.
Like they're banishing him to the bench forever.
They also have him, his contract's guaranteed for this year and next year. Ooh. So it's not as if they owe him a little bit.
Not a bunch of money though, right?
No, but running back money is always on a different scale.
Adam Thielen had a hamstring injury, came back early and hurt it again. There you go.
Case closed. I was going back to look at, I don't know if you remember, like Randy Moss pulled his hamstring pretty badly.
No, I don't remember that.
In like 2004, the year that Dante was, I think it was the year that he was like a MVP candidate, and he like pulled it in New Orleans, and he was very stubborn about it, wouldn't get an MRI, and he played the next two games and didn't do anything. They kept taking him out, and then eventually they sat him for like a month. And he came back, and then he played in the next two games. He didn't do a whole lot, and then finished the year with 200-yard season. So, and again, all hamstrings are different, but I just think that, like, having witnessed receivers trying to play with hamstrings, and also, like, and you mentioned Thielen, like, there was, and this came out in sort of the NFLPA review of the Vikings and part of why they were number one. Like, there's definitely been a culture shift in sort of the medical part of their operation from the football side, and to the whether it was real or perceived, the pressure to
get back
quicker no longer exists. And so you can debate what's the right and the wrong, but like that's where they're at right now. The players love that, obviously, and so we'll see.
Top of the hour pause. When we come back, we'll ask Seifert the big question: is the division ready?